Good evening, you're watching The Digital Age, and I'm James Goodale. Was Oprah right? As we all know, she changed her mind about A Million Little Pieces, but did she do the right thing? And who the heck is the blogger who caused all the trouble to begin with? And can mainstream media take it again in the chin? To discuss these questions tonight, we have none other than the person I called the blogger, who is Bill Bastone, who has the smoking gun as his blog. It's actually a website. I hope you don't mind if I call you
no
a blog.
No problem.
And on my left here is Tom Lipscomb. Thank you for coming in again, Tom. He is a senior fellow at Annenberg Center, but more importantly for this show, a former president of the New York Times Book Company. Now, Bill, excuse me for being irreverent, but who the heck are you? I mean, you've come out of nowhere to cause a huge publishing turmoil.
Yeah, well, we're about to turn 9 years old. Our website has been around since 1997, and we happened upon a story that, thanks to the connection with Oprah and the fact that the book has become, for the last 4 months, kind of a national phenomenon, the story ended up having incredible legs and kind of, you know, it's not often that we do stuff that ends up in the New York Times like virtually every day for 18 days in a row, but you add Oprah to the mix and a lot of other things, and things get combustible.
But what were you before? Did you come out, drop out of the sky to do a website? If I did a website, no one would watch it.
Right.
How did it happen?
I was a longtime investigative reporter at the Village Voice. I covered organized crime, municipal corruption, spent a lot of time in courthouses and the police shacks, and we decided to start a website as a side project to our regular kind of journalism gigs, and we thought the thing we would do would be a doc.
Who's we in that sentence?
We is my wife, Barbara Glauber, who's a graphic designer.
Oh, I see. You did this as a sideline.
Yes, this was a side project, and our friend Dan Green, who's a reporter in town. And we decided we do a website that was based on paper, documents. We thought, well, we'll bring paper to the internet. We thought that was kind of a ridiculous idea. And it turns out that people actually like to see, you know, primary source documents, so they feel that there's a certain degree of, they look at it and they feel like the documents are concrete and real, and that the story they tell, they can invest some, you know, they can believe what they're reading usually.
You're a senior fellow at the Annenberg Center. You're very much in the digital world. Is it a silly idea to bring paper to the web?
Not at all. As a matter of fact, what we're seeing with good websites like thesmokinggun.com, we're seeing what used to be investigative reporting in the newspaper business. But with the cutbacks on staff that have been going on by the bean counters, we're seeing less and less of it. And so we're being embarrassed in the mainstream media all the time, and I publish in the mainstream media, you know, everywhere from the New York Times to Chicago Sun-Times. We're seeing mainstream media being embarrassed by what they call the pajama-clad bloggers. And all I can say is it's good for the news. It may not be good for a lazy mainstream media.
Do you wear pajamas? No, I don't want to ask you that. But you do documents. You say you do documents. What do you mean by that, and how did that become relevant to
a million pieces. What we do is we're bringing the same kind of reporting standards and kind of reporters, you know, toolkit to what we do online, and that is we file freedom of information requests, we have sources, we get tips, but instead of just sitting down and writing, you know, like a 3,000 word story that I would have done in my prior life, I gather all the material and then just present it
online. You post
the
documents.
Yeah, so
Did you have documents in this case that you posted?
Yes, I mean, we...
What did you post?
This is where we posted all the police documents that dealt with the real account of what happened to Mr. Fry's interaction with the cops as opposed to what he said occurred in the thing. So it was a mixture of a very long narrative piece of journalism supplemented by documents and photos.
So what was this, the arrest record you showed? And it showed that the author here who was... obviously, for all of us sitting here in the audience too, has been charged effectively with writing a false book by Oprah Winfrey.
Correct.
Said that he had been arrested for, in jail for 60 days, and you actually found the record, and what did it say, six hours or something?
Well, actually, he claimed to have done 3 months in a county lockup, and it turned out we got the police reports, and he really spent about 4 or 5 hours in what essentially was a conference room of a police headquarters waiting for a buddy to bail him out. But
Jim, there's an important point here that I think you and I remember. And
I'm missing it?
Not only that you're missing it, I'm sure it's here somewhere. We were involved in the Pentagon Papers publication. You remember it cost a fortune to the New York Times Company and the Washington Post to run those huge, long papers day after day in print.
Okay? Right.
What we now can do on the
web, just put them on the web.
Is put them on the web at practically no expense. However, mainstream media still doesn't get it. Case in point, a year ago, John Kerry promised to get his records and to release them to the public. The Boston Globe got them, and so did the LA Times and the AP. No one put the documents up on the web. They simply ran extract stories. That's irresponsible.
If you have they should have put them on their own website.
Of course they should have. The American people wanted it. Kerry said he'd release it, and these three news organizations have suppressed the American people's ability to look at John Kerry's military.
Well, let's come back to the mainstream media in a minute again, but let me ask you some more questions about this story and trying to, trying to fit you into mainstream media since you're on the other side, maybe not intentionally, but that's where you've ended up. How did you get it? Did you get a tip on this? I don't want to go into your, but how do you go about starting?
We have a section of our site that's devoted to mugshots and booking photos of well-known people, politicians, athletes, celebrities. And in November, we got an email from someone who just, as we get a lot of emails, people suggesting stories. Someone said, get a mugshot of James Fry. You know, he's the top-selling author in the country.
I see.
He was arrested 14 times. So.
Has he been arrested 14 times?
No.
No.
Well, that's what he said.
That's what he said.
We eventually found out that wasn't the case. But so we thought, all right, people might want to see a photo of him. And we went and tried to find details on any of his 14 arrests and initially couldn't find anything. And for us, that set off alarms.
Oh, that set alarms.
And then
How many are there? There's your wife and you and Mr. Green?
Well, there's actually, we've kind of changed. My wife is a graphic designer, runs her own company, wanted nothing.
She's not in it.
She's out of it. She doesn't.
Mr. Green's still in it?
He does kind of business development stuff.
We're so how many? Three of you?
There's three of us. Andrew Goldberg is our managing editor. Joe Giselli is
So anyway, so three of you, and Court TV bought you, apparently.
Correct.
So you're probably very rich, but you don't have to tell me. But the three of you are sitting in a room with your computers, basically, and cranking out and bringing down mainstream media?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's kind of like we only do one thing, and that is everything we focus on has to have a paper trail to it. So we're not worried about having to get someone on the phone and do an interview over the phone.
I see. So everything works from the documents.
Everything is find the documents.
Yeah. I read your report, but I guess I didn't look at the documents. I mean, the report is really well written, New York Times style, but if anyone hasn't figured it thus far, if this isn't a digital age story, I give up. Three guys with three computers, effectively, we want to talk about whether, Oprah was right, but you've caused a huge stir at the very least. Now, let's go over to mainstream media.
Sure.
Now, this is, if you want to count them, this is like an event that you would also think in the same class with, that's a terrible sentence, Rathergate.
Easton Gate,
who is the CNN person who was fired for what he said at Davos. Newsweek gave up too early on talking about the Korans flushed down the toilet. We go on and on and on. What is going on here? Everything that mainstream media does is being undercut. Not everything, but a lot is being undercut by three gentlemen sitting in a small room, with their computers. I mean, this is incredible, isn't it?
It's incredible because what you're seeing is the arrogance of mainstream media. It isn't the journalism that's being undercut. They aren't practicing journalism. They're basically saying, if we say so, it's true. And it isn't just these three gentlemen. There are thousands of very intelligent people out there who can go do reporting and have access to millions of people who read the web, and they're comparing what is going on in mainstream media and what's happening on the web, and what's happening is the newspaper business is dropping like a stone.
Are we seeing the authority of the established press being attacked for all practical purposes? And have we seen an attack on authority ever since the Vietnam War? And this is just part of the same pattern that people are happy to see the authority figures undercut?
No, I don't think it's that. I think rather the press is so out of touch with the American people today. Pat Moynihan wrote a brilliant essay and commentary back in 1971 forecasting that this was going to happen, that we used to have, you know, high school dropouts who were drunk until noon and the cigarette smoke filled the newsroom, and there was a different ethos in the newsroom. Now they're all Ivy Leaguers. Some of them have PhDs. They're rich kids. They have no contact with the American people, and nobody wants to bother to read their newspapers.
Is this like a shadow government? Effectively, the bloggers like a shadow. Here we have government, the established authority of the press, and over here we have the shadow government, like the government out of power, the bloggers who are sitting to attack everything.
Well, what does the press say it is? The fourth estate? The fifth estate?
So it's really just doing...
It's now the sixth estate. It's now okay. And I think you're really looking at a situation in which the press better get back to its audience. One of the heads of the New York Times came to me the other day and said, how do you think we're doing on our hiring program? I said, terribly. And they said, why? I said, why don't you hire Americans? How many Boy Scouts do you have in this place? How many people that served in the military? How many people went to an agricultural college? You're not dealing with the America. You can't cover America if you don't have Americans. Yes, you need more
black
people.
Okay, now I've got to ask Mr. Bastone where he went to college.
New York University.
Well, that undercuts that theory.
The one point I want to make is I think that when we started our site, we didn't envision that this was going to be one of the outcomes, but we find that, you know, there's a real distrust of kind of people reading newspapers and magazines and that they don't necessarily believe what they read. And we constantly have people telling us it reassures them that they can come and look at the actual documents. Now, that wasn't what we were thinking about when we were doing it, but it's, you know, for us, it's kind of a sad reflection on kind of like the public's belief in what they read and whether they're getting straight stories from places that you think are supposed to be objective.
Now, you've been on both sides of the street because you work for the Village Voice.
Mm-hmm.
That's, in its way, an establishment paper. You switch sides, if you can put it that way. Did you not trust what you were doing yourself, or did people not trust what you were doing at the Village Voice? How do you explain the lack of trust?
No.
Because it would have to be lack of trust in you, in a sense.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know that I'd necessarily say that there was a lack of trust there. I'd say that I think what happened was, like, kind of once you realize that you're working on the internet, and we realized this the first day we put the site online, suddenly you're being exposed to every corner of the globe immediately.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell people that I could spend 4 months writing a story about someone. I could do a devastating, you know, investigative piece on someone. And if I got like 2 or 3 letters about it, I think, wow, it's pretty good.
But Bill, news hole is bigger in the internet. It's
sure.
Infinite. How long is a chain of hot dogs?
What do you mean by news? What's a news hole? What does that mean?
Well,
that's the amount of space that's in the paper without the advertisements, and it's limited by the amount of paper put out. He's saying it's infinite, but it's not infinite for you. It's as much as 3 people can deal with.
Right, as much as you can generate. But there's this kind of army of people out there, you know, who have interesting takes on stories and have other ways of thinking about things and can do their own reporting. I mean, you think mm-hmm. about kind of what happened to Dan Rather. Listen, that was investigative reporting started by people who were not investigative reporters, and it was smart people doing smart things, getting big results.
And my story on it was in the Chicago Sun-Times the next day. So mainstream media were there at that particular
hour. Okay, let me ask you about, is mainstream media going to be able to survive the onslaught of these type of anti-establishment stories that have come out?
It has to get its spurs back. It's lost its authority. It's got to start breaking major stories that are well-footed out and don't depend on secret sources, which they can't reveal. You've just got to, his doesn't depend on secret sources. He's got the documents. He's got the material. The American people are practical people, and their authority lets you say, the New York Times believes. Well, we're not taking that anymore. We want we know how we want our news. We want it backed up, and you can't do it that way anymore.
Okay, let's get into the book itself.
Mm-hmm.
The gentleman who wrote this book, who went on Oprah the first, no, he went on Larry King, and his position has been, I think it probably is still today, in fact, it is still today, that, all right, you found some mistakes. Matter of fact, why don't you tell the mistakes again, and then I come
sure.
back to
I mean,
him.
He basically, one of the... The main part of the book is his repeated assertion that at the time the book covers, he was a drug addict, a criminal, and an alcoholic. And he creates this persona for himself of this incredibly bad guy, this criminal, hitting cops with cars, spending time in jail, getting caught in possession of crack cocaine. It all feeds into this kind of characterization of him as a really terrible guy, because the payoff for the book is his salvation. So you got to seem you're really bad if there's going to be a real nice redemption tale at the end. And we just looked at the portions of the book that we knew would have a paper trail attached to them.
All right.
And they all turned out to be
But he says, okay, you're right, but there are only 60 pages out of, say, 400
right.
that are wrong. And that, therefore, what you found out doesn't destroy his message or the substance of his book. Your response?
I'd say that the only things we looked at, we only looked at a handful of things, and they all turned out to be wrong. So we'd say we were batting 1,000. And everything else basically relies on his word. And I'd say, if he lied about the things for which a paper trail existed, why would you possibly believe anything else he wrote when he's the only source for it? And, you know, I'm unaware now that there is kind of a metric of
sure.
telling the truth.
Well, I'll take the sake of your...
Wait, let me just get you for a second. Doesn't this book set out a person's recollection of what it was to go through drug rehab?
That's
and doesn't
true.
That message still remain valid regardless of how he takes the particular events and fictionalize them?
You mean like Dan Rather says, we didn't have the evidence, it was forged, but my story was still true?
No.
No, I don't buy that.
You don't, so you're saying based on 60 pages, that the whole book is false?
I don't buy the 60 pages wrong. Let's put it this way. If we took Hamlet as a play and we said Hamlet is all true, there are a few details and a few pages. For example, he didn't kill Polonius. He wasn't really a prince. They weren't his mother and father that are dealing with here. And he died a different way than it said in the book, in the play. I mean, that makes major changes, even though you may change three pages.
All you know, is that the 60 pages are not true.
No, I know they're more than that are not true.
62. But assume it's 60 or 62, where do you come out?
I come out with not publishing the book if I know it up front. But this is a case of, what form is this we're talking about? We're talking about a form publishers call the ought not to biography.
Well, okay. Can we do it the way it's usually described? Memoir and autobiography? Let me ask you. Now, is there any difference between a memoir and an autobiography?
Well, I mean, I guess he would argue that these are his recollections of what happened to him. But that doesn't cover inventing things that never happened. And he knew he was making stuff up, and he's admitted as much. I mean, he's basically telling you, well, it's essentially a nonfiction work, except for the fake stuff that's in it. And that's a new characterization for publishing.
Also, that wonderful thing he said about, I wanted to give it to them as fiction, but they insisted that I make it nonfiction, which turns out to be a lie, as the publisher refuted that. This man is lying at every level.
What's that got to do with anything?
It has a lot to do
with
it.
Well, I mean, that he didn't submit the work as fiction to Doubleday.
He claimed that he'd originally wanted to submit it as fiction.
Can I get you?
He has said that he went around to 17 publishers and said it was a fictional work. Doubleday declined to publish it as fiction, and it was published as nonfiction.
But
and Nantelis came out and said it was never, ever brought to them as anything but nonfiction.
All right, so can we accept that as a fact? Now, let me ask you the same question. I asked you a memoir. Memoir and autobiography, are they the same? And have you ever seen any autobiography or memoir that was 1,000% true? Is there a difference between the two genres?
I think there's a major thing we need to keep in mind in the field of memoir and autobiography. What is the important reason I'm publishing this? And I'll give you an example. We did the autobiography.
Who's we?
We, the New York Times, published the autobiography of Wilfred Burchett, the communist Australian journalist who had a very checkered past. My conclusion was, yes, he's lied a lot, but his life is incredibly important. Whatever it is, let other people refute it once it comes out, but let's get it on the record.
What was that? An autobiography?
An autobiography. All right, a memoir.
I mean, you published something you knew was false?
I knew a lot of what Wilfred Burchett thought
and
was true.
And did you say on the cover of the book that it was false?
I put in the book that this was one of the most controversial, questioned journalists of our day, and he raises many interesting issues.
Tom,
I didn't claim it was true. Publishers
have been doing this for years, exactly what you're doing, and that was an autobiography. Now, suppose you have a memoir.
I had one of Diana Mitford. All right, Lady Diana Mitford. That was a memoir.
An autobiography. What was the difference between a memoir and an autobiography?
An autobiography generally covers the entire life of a person.
Okay.
A memoir can be my time in the cabinet. Okay.
Do you have the same standards of accuracy, so forth and so on, for a memoir as you do for an autobiography?
Yes, I do. It has to have significant, important material in it, so I'll publish it. And I will be willing to accept the fact that Wilfred Burchett and the most famous fascist of England's history at the time both have self-interest and faulty memories where it comes
what
to
is,
things.
I don't understand the difference between what you did with Burchett and what Doubleday did with this book.
Doubleday went out and claimed
difference?
It was all true. I never have done that in my life. They claimed it was true. Their publicity material was irresponsible, and they did so with no investigation of the author or any hard questions, which was irresponsible and bad publishing.
All right, now.
And they did that because they saw that that was the way to market the book and make money, and it turned out that was the... Because, listen, if they said, this is a fictional account, this guy made up this stuff, no one would care, because the power of the book is that you can look in the back page and see James Fry's face and say, that's
the guy. No one would care if he had said?
If this was a fictional book, it wouldn't have sold 1% of what it sold.
Right.
If it even was published.
Absolutely.
And how do you think this book is going to do now when it goes back to press? Shouldn't the marketplace decide whether truth matters or not?
The marketplace wants to be entertained. This is classic sob sister female marketing, okay? And they'll do just fine.
Well, then you disagree with them.
No.
Because he said
it's been launched.
If you put it in there.
Look, if Marilyn Monroe, before her first movie, they came out and said, well, she's done some pornographic films that we think she has a lot of talent, she'll never get off the ground. Once she's down there selling millions and millions of dollars worth of tickets and it comes out, it doesn't hurt her career, it makes it more interesting. Same thing with this guy.
Now, back when you were a reporter.
Mm-hmm. I still am a reporter. I just do it in a different way.
Absolutely.
Your pardon.
Different medium.
It's hard to think of a person who has his own website as a reporter, but you are, of course, I apologize for that. Shows my mainstream media bias. But when you were a reporter for the Village Voice, old-time reporter, did you think that everything you wrote was 100% perfectly accurate?
Well, I mean, to the best of my ability. I mean, if I'm relying on a source to provide me information, I do the best I can to confirm it. If I can get documents that support it, you can get firsthand accounts. Yeah, I mean, I never wrote a thing that I knew to be incorrect. Would I have written stories that had facts in them that were wrong? Sure I have. I mean, I wouldn't say that it was anything that was major because I come from a place
what I'm trying to get at. Isn't the standard in the publishing? You want to ask Thomas?
What standard? I was aware that there was one.
Well, that's my point. But isn't the standard, quote unquote, effectively in the publishing world that you're substantially correct, and you're never 100% correct? Do you buy that or not?
Well, they don't fact check nonfiction books. I mean, it's basically on the author's say so, and they could have done some fact checking on this guy, and it would have fallen apart.
Do you buy the concept of substantial? Truth, substantial correctness?
I think we have to talk about the medium we're talking about, all right? Is the Jerry Springer show substantially correct and factual? That's a medium of television. Is Oprah Winfrey substantially? Apparently not, according to her yesterday.
Substantially what?
Correct and factual. She said she'd been duped, and she ran his publicity campaign for him. God bless her for being brave enough, unlike CBS and the New York Times, in admitting her guilt.
Do you make any mistakes on your website?
It's very hard to make mistakes because basically we put the documents up and basically we stick to
write stories.
Yeah,
I mean, you have to draw conclusions with the document. Ever had a fake document? How do you
never,
know? Never. Do you think you ever have one?
Never. I mean, we get them directly.
Now, let's talk about Oprah.
Okay.
Did Oprah do the right thing?
Well, she ignored her own producers who already knew a lot of this guy's story was fraudulent up front and warned her.
Well, wait a minute. Let's go back to the beginning.
Yeah.
The beginning is that when she was warned from whomever, namely from the author himself, she went on at the very end of Larry King and said, it makes no never mind, to coin a Manhattan phrase, that the story is substantially what it is, and I don't care about this other stuff. Did she do the right thing to change her mind? What has changed?
Nothing could be better than to change her mind.
But what has changed?
What has changed is that she has now gotten enough information. Remember, she's putting on a show. She's working 24 hours a day. She ignored
Wait a minute. Wait, 24 hours.
Media happens under certain conditions. You have to look at the overall condition. If you want to ask me if she's right, I have to look at under what circumstances.
I want to focus on her change of decision because I don't see what changed from the moment that she was on Larry King, which was a week before she did a show in which she said she changed. What has changed? Didn't the bloggers get her?
I know it got her. I mean, first, when she said it to Larry King, she'd never read our story. It was clear she then read the story. But what happened was...
She had not read your story.
No, she clearly didn't read. But what happened was...
she must have known what your story said.
I think she had people kind of explain it to her, and she dashed off some of the points. But what happened was, and there's no doubt about what happened, this is the first time in her career that Oprah Winfrey got smacked around on the editorial pages of the New York Times, the LA Times, the Boston Globe, Maureen Down, Ellen Goodman. It just
and how about the bloggers?
And she was getting destroyed online and on her own website.
All right, so now we got the situation where the bloggers have got her for whatever reason. And so she takes a whole hour on television to make her response and effectively cave in. I mean, there's no difference between her original position and her second position in terms of the facts.
I disagree with you.
She is just trying to save her reputation with a whole hour of time devoted to...
Alex Haley didn't try and save his reputation when he was under fire. I mean, there any number of frauds have kept on down the primrose path, and she got duped. She took it on the chin. However long it takes you to see the light, when you do, and you make a public one-hour statement of that, that is admirable. All the media can do is clean its own house when it's faced with facts.
It would have been very easy for her to just act like James Fry. Never mentioned James Fry's name, and it would have disappeared in a couple of more weeks. And
I want to know what's happened to the message. Just from personal point of view, I'm very curious about the institution, which is the subject of this book, which is Hazelden.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Hazelden's a very interesting institution because it has rich and famous people there. I think it is true that there was a judge there.
Correct.
When Fry was there. I think it was true that there were other people of similar place in society. It's a very interesting place. And I want to know how it works. It seems to have worked in Fry's case. I mean, I don't think he's a druggie.
No, of course,
he may go back on drugs. That's not fair.
But
anyway, what's happened to the message? Because the message that Oprah made when she went on Larry King was, I am interested, what I've just said, I'm interested in. What's happened to that message? Why isn't that message still just as valid as it was?
Well, this is what I'd say. He presents himself as a certain kind of addiction, a certain kind of personality, a persona, a problem child that he really wasn't. And the thing that I think has upset people...
I'm going to have to stop as we come to an end. I'm trying to cut you in the end. So I want to... The last question was, Oprah right or wrong, yes or no, Tom Lipscomb?
In turning and saying she was duped and it was a mistake for 1 hour, I think she was terrific.
Thank you very much,
You're welcome.
Tom Lipscomb. And was Oprah right or wrong?
I'd say she was right, albeit 2 weeks late.
Thank you, Bill Bastone.
Thanks very much.
And thanks for coming by. And thank you for coming by, and come by next week and learn more about the digital age. I mean, this was a digital age story, wasn't it? For the digital age, I am James Goodale. Good night.